The Financial Planner, presented by the Bombay Stock Exchange, IPF.
Hello and welcome. You're watching Financial Planner, your one-stop shop for learning everything about financial planning. And also these days, now you can pick up the basics of the stock markets right over here. My name is Smriti Rao. I'm in conversation with Certified Financial Planner Sumeet Ved. We'll be talking about some things that you need to know if you're looking to invest in shares. And then we'll start taking viewer queries. We love to hear from you. So if you have any questions about your money, your investments, or whether your financial goals are on track, you can write in to us at financialplanner@utvmoney.com. We're trying to put up clips on Facebook. So if you missed the show, if you want to go back and refer back to something else, you can always do that on Facebook at facebook.com/Smriti Rao. Smriti is S-M-R-I-T-I. All right, Sumeet, welcome. Thanks so much for coming back. So let's get started with what we were, let's pick up the conversation from last time, because we were talking about IPOs, and for anyone who's interested in IPOs or wants to know how to subscribe to them, we just wanted to run you through a couple of basic things. What does it mean for a company to go public? What does it mean when someone says, look, the, are the IPOs on? A price band has been set. We were talking about how the price band is determined. And then we were also discuss a little bit more about what SEBI's role in all of this actually is. But today, let's talk about how you and I can subscribe to an IPO. We look at a company, we like what it does, we think that it has a great future, but how can you participate in that company's growth? So if I... I'm watching the news and I see something and I'm like, wow, I'm really excited about this company. Mm-hmm. It's a chance for me to invest in that company. How do I go about subscribing to an IPO? Do I need a DMAT account for this?
Yes, that's the must. Whenever you talk about equity markets and talk about participating, mm-hmm. I think first thing which we need to keep in mind is that we need to have a DMAT account. And DMAT account should be in name of individuals. There's no DMAT account in name of family. So, you know, as many family members you have, if you want them to access capital markets or equity markets, then you need to have DMAT account. Mm. And DMAT account, just like your bank account, can be opened with your bank, can be opened with your stockbroker, can be opened with any other so-called investment consultant and advisor who can help you access capital market. They might have direct DMAT account providing... facilities for you, mm-hmm. or you might do it indirectly as a sub-broker to one of the large brokers. But there is first step is have a DMAT.
Yeah.
Once you have a DMAT, the second thing is you need to get hold of a application form for this particular
IPO. Where do you get the application form?
As I said, you need to have an investment advisor, consultant, who can be a stockbroker, who can be your bank, who can be your financial planner or family financial planner. They will give you access to this application forms, which needs to be filled up in a certain manner with the details, with the most important detail, which is your PAN number. Because PAN number, you don't move ahead at all. Mm. And then it gets given to the R&T agent via collecting bank branches or through your brokers / investment advisors.
Right. All right. So basically, the main takeaway is you need a DMAT account.
Yes.
You need to have a PAN number.
Definitely.
And then you need to have someone who can get you that application form,
True.
In which case can be a broker or a financial
True.
Advisor. So my question is, can I apply for an IPO and put in multiple applications? Can I do that?
No. Don't even think about doing something like that. That's not at all allowed. Your application will be completely rejected. And you'll not get access the right quality of this IPO. And the reason why it's like that, there used to be a lot of these unhealthy market practices way back in past, where people used to apply multiple applications so that their chances of getting certain share through the system of allotment of shares is very high, which is not right, which is not being encouraged right now in the market. So no multiple applications.
In a single name. Right. Okay. So and you were saying earlier about a processing agent, someone who actually moves this thing along,
True.
And that's a registrar, isn't
that's
it?
True.
Can you talk about what the role of a registrar is and who this person is? So if you, Sumeet and company, are actually going public,
yes.
what is your connection with the registrar?
See, there's a lot of paperwork, formalities and legal things which need to be taken up when an IPO is being done. So there's a large amount of people who are participating in IPO across the country.
So
they're putting in
money. If I'm putting in my application form and,
yes.
you know, so... and you're the company that's issuing the shares. I'm the one who's actually going ahead and applying for those shares. So the registrar is sort of the middleman, isn't it?
It's the back office.
No? It's the back office.
It's a simple way of explaining it to our viewers. It's the back office where all the clerical works, legal works, you know, reconciliation works of money is coming in, money is getting sorted out, money is getting passed on to the company through the lead managers, right number of shares getting allotted to each basis, and other technicalities and legal framework which is need to be followed as per the regulation gets taken care of.
So, registrar
is basically a back office provider who, as per the regulations, makes sure all the paperwork required to make sure an IPO gets completed in the right way. Do it.
Right. So they are also independent financial institutions that are registered with SEBI and also the stock exchanges.
True.
So you have to be a registered institution. You just
That's
can't
right.
be some random person.
No, you can't.
And they're
be.
Appointed by the company going public. So you, Sumit Ten Company, will actually appoint a registrar to make sure that all the paperwork gets processed.
That's right.
And like you said, the responsibility is mostly involves processing of those IPO applications to also allocate shares to the people based on SEBI guidelines.
Sure.
Process refunds. And then transfer those allocated shares to the respective DMAT account.
True.
So if I have a DMAT account and I apply for the shares, all the back office work is done by the registrar, like you explained. All right, so we just sort of went through the whole life cycle of an IPO, as it were, from the time when a company decides to go public till the time that I, investor, applies for it. But how does a company decide who gets the shares?
Okay, now this is a very well-documented system through the regulator, which gets monitored and which gets applied by the lead manager. There is a book-running lead manager. You know, there's a term which is known as book-running, which is the lead manager, which is the main manager who has the decision-making in terms of what this process will be and the responsibilities and authorities to make sure this allocation happens in a pre-decided format, keeping the regulations in mind.
Right, yeah.
So they decide based on how much money has come in, at what price band it has come in. You know, last episode we were discussing about people will apply at different price bands. So a price band will be considered. Then there are various categories of investors. There's an institutional category, there's a high net worth category, there's a retail category, and sometimes there are some special, you know, benefits are given to especially retail category in form of some special discounts, etc. All these things, as per the terms and condition of IPO, are kept in mind while going through the allocation process. It's basically demand and supply analysis, which determines what is the right price based on categories and regulations.
All right. So I'm just looking through what are the things that maybe we can just review, because we've talked about IPOs quite a bit and in detail. So if I can just run through the life cycle of an IPO from the beginning, just to sort of recap for those of you who missed the episode. If Sumit is a company and he wants to go public, the first thing he does, of course, is make a draft offer document, basically talking about what his company is, what it does, and then he submits it to SEBI. SEBI takes a look at it, and then it reviews it and vets it.
True.
And after that, I just want to also remind you that these draft documents are available on SEBI's website under Reports Public Issues. So what you can also do at home is go to the website, which is sebi.gov.in, and basically look at a couple of other draft documents that are available there. It'll give you an idea of what different companies are talking about and what their idea is. It also talks about the business management, the risk involved in applying for the issue. Companies are bound by law to openly disclose what are the legal cases pending against
them. That's right.
And also the sort of risk associated if you invest with them. So
True.
No one can technically hoodwink you into applying
True.
For
that. But that also leads us to a very interesting point, which we should highlight. You know, as an investor who's looking at investing in IPOs, please read through the offer document.
Yeah.
You know?
And which is so funny because I do think to a certain extent that a lot of investors, maybe they know it, maybe they don't know it, but please remember that these documents are available for public consumption on SEBI's website. So you can go there and everything's there for you to see.
True. And it is your responsibility. You cannot say my investment advisor or my investment consultant or my broker has gone through this. That's the wrong way of doing it. It's your hard-earned money. Prime responsibility is your, and the best way you can, you know, fulfill your responsibility while going through the IPO is go through the offer document, and if you don't understand anything which doesn't make sense to you, ask your lead managers, ask your broker, and try and get clarity. Once you are convinced completely with what you have read, what you understand the business to be, then only invest in IPO. Do not try and do this timing bit, which many a time happens. This so-called misconception in India that IPO is a lottery system. You know, if you get an IPO, any IPO, when it lists, it'll make money and you'll get out. That's a wrong way of doing it. That's a very risky way of doing it. To me, that's not investing.
Right, and we've also seen that out of the bunch of IPOs that have come out over the last quarter or so, since December till now, there were maybe 11 or 14 IPOs. A lot of them have gone bust. A lot of investors didn't really make money, except for one or two big IPOs. A lot of investors aren't making money. So you have to be sure about what IPO you apply for and also know a little bit more about the company.
True.
Like we said, all the information is out there in public, and make sure that you read it. Okay, on that note, let's wrap up this segment. We'll come back and then we'll talk about one of our viewers. He wrote in, he says he lives in Nigeria and he wants to know if he should be getting health insurance over there. Should he not? We'll talk about that after this break.
The Financial Planner, presented by the Bombay Stock Exchange, IPF.